Hi all, and you're joining me just now for a show that's a little bit different from normal. This one's actually going to be focused on the hobby, as opposed to just going on about games all the time. And in this show, I am joined by Dave Crabtree, aka Gothy Dave.
Hi, folks.
Not as a certain people's champion with Crabby, a fucking oh.
Look of disappointment on your face when he said that.
Oh, just like seriously, it's like the goth kids in South Park are based on you. It's a little known fact, folks, but when Dave was over in America quite a few years ago now, he ran into Matt Trey, and 3 months later, the goth kids appeared in South Park. Now, it could just be coincidence, but
Yeah, no, that's absolutely true. No need to Google
I've seen you on Faye, I've seen you dancing, it's pretty much there.
it. Yeah, it is actually. It's scarily accurate.
So I got Dave on to talk about his armies because Dave is a pretty unique style. I think it would be fair to
Sounds so
say.
unique.
Yeah, I'd say your Kings of War armies tend to be a bit less extreme than some of your old fantasy ones, I have to admit.
Not anywhere near as overtly gruesome as one of them in particular.
Let's just say there are less mutilated bits of genitalia in these ones.
Yep, exactly.
So I've whacked up the first one here, Dave. This is your first unit. So this is this your Abyssal's army?
Yep, this is the Abyssals with some Nightstalker allies in the full army, more or less doing them as two armies side by side. So the first unit is the Abyssal Horsemen. Now that was a lot of this army is based on a bit of Lovecraft, a bit of surrealist art. So Wayne Barlow, H.R. Giger, people like that. A guy whose name I will never pronounce his first name, but Beksinski. Something to that effect. Sorry if I've murdered his. Oh shit, that guy was actually murdered. Oh, there's the first faux pas. Anyway, I wanted to try and get across some of the sort of surrealist imagery into this army. So a lot of very heavy sculpting and conversion work throughout. This particular unit was very much based on some of Wayne Barlow's work, which had these processions through hell. A lot greener than his. His was much more a fire and brimstone looking hell, but similar idea.
So what is it you've made the bulk of them out of then? Is it green stuff or clay?
What I do whenever I'm sculpting is I use three materials. I'll start off by twisting paper clips into a skeleton and armature. Then I will coat that with a layer of Milliput. Now the reason for that is A, it's a lot tougher than green stuff when it dries. It's also a hell of a lot cheaper. So for your basic bulk and shape, Milliput is absolutely fine. Some people will then use Milliput for detail work. I'm not a fan of it myself. It's a bit clay-like, almost. So I will then go on and do green stuff over the top of that, but pretty much in bulk from Silmaster, because I go through a lot of it. Green stuff is there for your extra details, picking out things like faces and so on, and never ever hands, because I can't do hands.
Oh, yeah, forget you don't do hands, do you? So always tentacles.
Always tentacles. I've tried doing hands. I can do a hand, but I can't make two that are roughly the same size.
So it's just a good job you get you quite like a lot of the demonic things in, really.
It is really. I always advise anybody who is looking at trying out green stuff and sculpting or conversion work, pick something evil. It's a hell of a lot easier to start with.
Now, the paint scheme for this army, if anyone out there's ever played me with, I'll say my undead, but the undead I
Was.
originally bought from you a hell of a long time ago. You went through quite a few paint schemes and you seem to have came back to the sort of object lighting for this one.
Yes. This was in part due to discovering fluorescent paints, which are a nightmare to use, but end up quite effective when it's finished. And again, this was to tie in with the surrealist theme. I wanted something very alien looking and try to create a sort of otherworldly landscape. Because in my sort of head background to this, it's based on the utter dark, which we don't know a lot about other than it's dark and it's cold and there's old Lovecraftian things living
Yeah.
there. So yeah, this paint scheme, in retrospect, with the heavy conversions, maybe not the best idea, because I think that could add a layer of confusion for some people, particularly people who struggle a bit with greens. You know, it could blur in, but you know, hindsight's 2020. And there's actually very little to no black in this. It's pretty much just greens and various shades of greys. A little touch of yellow.
So,
In fact, there's a tip for anybody wanting to do a very quick and easy black. Get yourself a pot of German grey. There's a couple of places that do them. And give it a black wash.
nice. Well, this I've moved the screen now onto the next, like, I'm gonna call it a thing, Dave, because I really don't even
That's
know what
fair.
that
That's
is.
fair. This is the Well of Souls.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yep. There's no model out for it currently. Mantic don't do one. So I wanted to again follow on the surrealist theme. We've got a touch of H.R. Geiger in the thing on top, and try to make it look like something that's spewing out a ectoplasmic river. So yeah, this was built in essentially three parts. So the thing on top, then the platform with the heads and faces, and the base with the stem on it separate, and fitted together before spraying and painting.
And what's the actual stem made out of? Is that green stuff in Milliput as well? Because it looks quite sturdy.
It is. It's. I think I used, instead of the paper clip in the center of that, I used some brass rod just to make it extra secure. But Milliput, as long as you're not doing really thin things trying to prop something heavy up, Milliput will give you a lot of support. So I wouldn't want to drop it and see what happens, but general play and wear and tear, it should be reasonably okay with.
So next. Now, I like these guys. I do like this. It's a simple paint scheme you've done, especially around the eyes, but it's very effective with the actual models.
Oh, thank you very much. Yep, this is for my nature army, which was originally going to be a wood elf army for Warhammer, but end times hit and I more or less dropped out of the hobby for a year or two there. It revived it as a Forces of Nature army and Kings of War. These are, again, more Milliput. Not as much green stuff on these because I did the mix on them that I used for my basing there. All that is PVA glue mixed with dried parsley.
All right.
You can pick up in a supermarket. Makes a decent forest mulch type base once it's painted.
Yeah, that does look, they do actually look like you spent a lot of time modelling them.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, they're relatively simple to do. I think, again, talking about anybody who's fancies a go at sculpting something, but they're not quite sure where to start. Earth elementals, brilliant start. You can use bits of twig, bits of rock, anything like that to cover up any mistakes you might make. Really forgiving start. And the eyes there were basically my first experiment with the fluorescent paints, which I then followed on through with the whole Abyssal army.
So next unit, we've got some elves.
Yes. Like I say, this was originally going to be a wood elf army, with a bit more of a my taste colour scheme and style. So I've ended up using these now as the Naiad heart piercers, which are a fairly decent unit, I think. And this is the point where I say this Nature Army broke me, because the amount of detail on those models and the amount of edge highlighting to do, it just becomes a chore after a while.
Yeah.
So I have more recently taken up, I think it was Chris Walsh's advice, which is when it comes to multibasing, you don't need to do every bit on the model. And it really makes a difference.
I'm toying with that. I have to admit, just it goes so against my religion. I paint the bits that are underneath and everything nobody ever sees. Yep.
No, I'm 100% with you there. I'm trying to train myself not to do it. Mm-hmm. Some of them, yeah, I can't help it. And I've not quite gone so far as gluing them on the multibase and then doing
I can't do that.
But baby steps, I think. Mm-hmm.
Next up then, we have, different army entirely.
Yep, this is the herd. For anybody wondering why I have so many armies, it's because I don't have a great attention span.
True.
It's one of the, I've always enjoyed building up and painting a particular theme for an army, probably more than any other part of the hobby. It's that new army feeling that I like, mm-hmm. and trying out different ideas. So the herd is based on, it's not Mordheim, similar game, that do the plastic kits.
Oh, is that Frostgrave?
Frostgrave, that's it. Thank you, I had a complete mind blank there. Yeah, these are based on the Frostgrave Gnolls and the Barbarians, with some werewolf heads, which I think were from Max Mini. Yes, some of them were from Max Mini, I think some of the others were from Poppets War. Mm-hmm. Basically wanted a bit of an illusion. Again, in my head in the backstory, I've always liked the Wendigo mythology, mm-hmm. which is sort of Northern American cannibalistic spirits that live in the frozen forests and mountains. And I figured, yeah, that sort of thing's ideal for a herd army.
Yeah.
And it gave me an excuse to try out the crushed glass for snow.
Well, is that what that is? I was wondering, mm-hmm. what you used, because I've just done snow myself recently.
Yes, it's... I think Secret Weapon do little pots of crushed glass. If you're going to use it, really take care. You don't want that stuff in your eyes. You don't want to breathe it in. Be sensible with it.
Yeah, I was just thinking that when you said crushed glass. I'm like, that sounds, yeah, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, it's one of those that wash your hands after using it straight away, because... And don't spill it, because that stuff will wreak havoc on your lungs if you breathe it in, and havoc on your eyes if you get it there. They recommend mixing it with water effects, mm-hmm. which I did try, and it looks good, but it's a little too slushy, too icy for me. So I actually mixed it with, it's almost like industrial strength PVA glue. And it ended up a lot thicker. I then sprinkled a little bit of a more regular snow effect. I think it was Gale Force 9 over the top, just to give the slight fluffiness on top. The hope being that it would look almost like new snow on top of old.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think you succeeded in that one.
Thank you very much.
Oop, next up, is that a toy, Dave?
It is a toy. It is a toy. Now, there's been a bit of controversy about toys.
Yeah.
If you are following Kings of War Fanatics, you will have seen stuff on this. If you like, I can give you the brief rundown of my opinion on it.
Go on. I actually tried to. I was recording another show earlier today, and I twice recorded my opinion on it and stopped because I was just getting angry and ranty.
That's fair enough. Right. First of all, there are good toys out there. Pappo, Schleich, Collector. That there is a Collector Diadom. Not sure on the pronunciation. And they do decent quality toys that, with a bit of conversion work, a bit of a decent paint job, don't look out of place. And it's that out of place that is probably a key phrase here. Because to my mind, this is a fantasy game. It's quite an open fantasy game. You can do more or less what you want, so long as it looks like a fantasy army. And for me, that's your line. I suppose, for me, the ideal is that it would fit in the setting in some way, which I think, to be honest, the majority do. But if somebody wanted to do like a historical army, say Napoleonic British, with all the regimental uniforms and things, that's fine. Still looks like an army. Where I do have a problem is with like cartoon toys, that sort of thing. At that point, I think, yeah, there's a line crossed here. If you are going to do something like that, I think the guy with the minions took them in addition to like a quote unquote proper army, which again, fair enough. And obviously, if you're playing at home or you've got kids and you want, they want to use some of the toys in the game, absolutely fine. Just don't be that guy.
You summed up my feelings in a much politer manner with a lot less swearing.
Thank you. I did have to remove something I'd written on the Facebook page because I was a little too ranty there. I thought, no, this is not a good look.
Because there's no way I'd say, look at this, there's absolutely no way. I only know it's a toy because you told me you'd made it off a toy. If you hadn't told me, I would have been like, what model's that?
And this is it. I mean, I use toys quite a bit in my armies. And I've even had some of the very ardent anti-toy people say, oh, what model's this? So it's a toy, mate. It's had some conversion work and it's been painted up, but yeah, it's a children's toy at the end of the day.
So what's this in the arm? What is this actual unit in the arm of them?
Yes, in the army, what you can't see as well on that particular picture is there's the howdah on top with the rider. So this would be a chieftain on a chariot. Partly because I don't really see that used. Looking at it on paper, yeah, the Lycan Alpha is the better choice, probably. But I don't think is a bad option. And it gave me an excuse to do something big and drooly.
Yeah, I've seen that. The jewels, there was quite a nice little effect there.
No, thank you very much.
I think it's one thing. It's one of the things I like about your work is it's what I think a lot of folk don't realise is we always focus on the painting a lot as a thing, and a lot of times it's the little touches and the converting etc. that really can make an army stand out. It just depends whether
Yes.
you're trying to build an army or you're going for. It's in my mind. There's always a distinct difference between best painted and best army. Almost best painted is exactly what it says.
Yeah.
Who's got the best brushwork? Armies are all about
Exactly.
conversions and themes, etc.
Yeah. And this is why in the UK, Chris Walsh is very popular for best armies because he does everything. He paints to an extremely high standard, but he also does a load of conversion work. And if anybody's seen his bases, well, you'll know what I'm getting at.
And he does it all
But you're
really
absolutely
quickly.
right. I know.
That's the part I don't get. That I can understand the rest of what he does, and I'm looking at going, given a space of months and months, possibly I could do that. But it's the fact he does it in like weeks.
Yeah, it's just unreal. Anybody who hasn't seen his stuff, go on the Fanatics page and look it up because it is fantastic. And Paul Welsh is another one, actually, who's I think he is only fairly recent to the game, isn't he?
Yeah, he's only just done his first tournament, but he rocked up with the whole all the LED kitted out Fallen, etc. It's a very nice army.
And I think that tournament was definitely a contest between those two in terms of the painting. But what you're saying about the, it's the extra touches, you're spot on. I think that as a hob, from a hobby point of view, multibasing is huge. That gives you so much freedom to mess about and try things. And let's be honest, tell a story with your units. You know, you've got the obvious example of like undead going through a graveyard or being raised out of the ground and so on. But there's, I think we're only just starting to see people really experimenting with what can be done with the multibasing.
Yeah, well, the guy who won the Clash of Kings best painted, he had you know, almost all, it was I think it was from Spain or Portugal. Sorry if I can't remember. Sorry if I got it wrong. I'm sure that won't be an issue.
That's the lion one.
Yeah, it was all multi-based, but each of them were little like diamori. Am I you saying that? I'm not pronouncing that right.
Diorama.
Diorama. That's the word I'm looking for. Diorama, and you're with guys falling off the horses and all this kind of stuff. Yeah. And it was a really nice little touch.
No, absolutely. I think he was from Spain, but I don't want to.
Yeah, I can't quite remember. I think it was Spain.
But yeah, that was, again, a fantastic. Loads of character put in there. And I'll be honest with you, I do like a lot of Mantic Rangers. The Basileans aren't one of them, unfortunately. But I think he really made the most out of the models.
Yeah.
And it's sort of the first time that I'd seen that army and thought, oh, I could do an army, an army of those myself.
So what then would be your kind of top tips? What were Dave Crabtree's top tips for budding hobbies out there?
First of all, think of something new to try out. Each army you do, try something a little bit outside of your comfort zone. Doesn't need to be massive, you know, you don't need to go from never doing lighting to an entirely night army. Just maybe try it on the eyes of a model here or there. Freehand is something that I'm not great at, so I try and do a little bit here and there. It's by doing things like that and just building yourself up gradually that you get comfortable with these techniques and eventually get good at them. The other thing I would say is always keep an eye out for things that inspire you. That can be absolutely anything. It could be books, films, games, artwork. Just think of something interesting and a bit different that you don't really see people doing a lot, and see what you can make of it. I think the novelty of seeing something new is a much bigger deal than a lot of people expect it to be. In terms of the sculpting side, don't buy Games Workshop green stuff because it's an absolute ripoff. Have a look at Milliput for your basic stuff and companies like Silmaster, which Silmaster is a UK company, and it's one of those that's in the, you know, those halfway between a craft shop and a DIY shop sort of things. Yeah, and I will actually echo some of Chris Walsh's advice here after driving myself spare with the Nature Army. Not every single part of the model needs to be highlighted up to perfection, because ultimately a lot of it just won't be seen.
Yeah, I'm going to try and do that one with my next army.
It's baby steps, isn't it? I think because coming from, both me and you came from a Warhammer background, where individual models would be picked up and taken off, and people would, if they liked your army, they would come and say, do you mind if I have a look at this model? And they'd do the turning it round and examining all the gaps and things. So it's a mindset.
Yeah, because I'm the same as you. We're doing that herd army I've just finished. It almost killed me. Just took me so long to get the final bits finished, and I can't be bothered doing that again. So I need to change something.
Yeah. I suppose I'm a bit with you on this one. I've not quite worked up the courage to gluing them down to the base and then picking the detail out. But you could probably do like a dry fit, you know. If you're pinning them to your base, just pin but don't glue. See how it looks and see which immediate bits stick out needing touching up.
Yeah. Possibly.
It's an option.
I will experiment with my next army, whatever I decide to go with in the end. But nope. Thank you very much for joining us, Dave. That's been quite fascinating.
Hopefully, thank you for having me.
Yeah. Hopefully you at home found that useful and take a bit of inspiration from that. And I'll see you next time. Cheers.
Cheers.